Hello, St. Anne Parish, and welcome to this week's Quick Things and a conversation, a very important conversation. But first of all, some quick things and also important things. A reminder of our summer jam coming up on June 18th, so our big weekend of celebration. We'll get to June 19th in a minute, but June 18th is summer jam. Still a few important volunteer spots open for folks to help make summer jam a success. There's a link with this email. You can also find the link via the website. There are, well, if you're online, you don't need to use the paper sign-up sheets at Mass, but there are paper and pen sign-up sheets at Mass. So please be attentive to that as summer jam gets closer, our day-long festival. Also, we have a golf outing coming up. There's too much stuff happening in June, but there's a golf outing on Monday, June 27th. It's at Greenwood Hills Country Club. Information is with this email. You can register there. All the stuff you need is online. You can also get sign-up materials at Mass this weekend. So summer jam and the golf outing, important things to know about, as well as in this email is a link to the video for the diocesan diocesan and parish capital campaign inspired by the Spirit, the official campaign video, and as well as a link to my at Mass introduction a few weeks back. So of our weekend of celebration, Saturday is summer jam. Sunday, June 19th is the dedication of the altar in our renovated church and our celebration of the completion of that renovation. So in recent quick things, we have focused primarily on the renovation, the construction, the progress, et cetera, that's being made. But as we get closer and as that begins to wind down, I think we can say it's beginning to wind down. I thought it would be helpful and really rather informative, I think, to talk about the dedication rite itself. And so joining me, I'm very happy to introduce to all of you, is my friend, Father Chris Roush from the Diocese of Grand Rapids. He's the pastor of Holy Trinity Parish in, gosh, Chris, I just forgot the name.
Comstock Park.
He's only been there a couple of years, so, and I've only been there once. So I knew where he was. I could have said where he was before very easily. So Holy Trinity Parish in Comstock Park, Michigan, again in the Diocese of Grand Rapids. So Chris and I were seminary classmates. So we've been friends since 1991, Chris, if you can believe that. And we were newspaper people before we went to the seminary, so we have that in common. I've talked about my August vacations in Michigan, going to the family cottage of my friend, and that's Chris. So it's Chris's family cottage in central Michigan, near really nowhere, right, Chris? It's not near anything. Right. Chris is with us today for two reasons, really. First of all, he studied liturgy at Notre Dame, University of Notre Dame, and has a master's degree in liturgical studies. Is that the official title? But maybe more importantly, he has experience as a pastor of being in parishes where altars were dedicated twice to an altar in each of those parishes, right? So he has the experience of what we will be experiencing in a week or so.
And yes, so my role in the office for worship of the diocese for 7 years. I also got to oversee the dedication of a few altars.
Sure.
And I even get to, as part of the committee I'm on, we review plans for church buildings and just make sure they kind of comply and work for the community.
Can you tell us, let's begin by just talking about simply, why is the altar so important? So why do we make a big deal of the dedication of the altar?
Yeah. If the altar, so a lot of what I'm using for my resource is the actual document, right, for the dedication of an altar, part of the dedication of a church. But the altar, you think about in your dining room, what's the principal piece of furniture in your dining room? The table, of course. I know more and more kitchens have the island. That's kind of the destination. When we come to a church, the altar is our destination. The altar represents a number of things, as Led explains. First of all, it's the table of sacrifice and the Paschal banquet. It's where we gather, as Jesus told us to do at the Last Supper, to gather and do this in memory of him. So the altar is where we gather around to do the action of the Eucharist. It's a table of sacrifice, hearkening back to the sacrifices of the Jewish folks in their temple, but also remembering it's the sacrifice where Christ, we were being met, the sacrifice of Christ for us on the cross. It's also a spiritual altar. And that's interesting. I had forgotten about this one. And this has come from the right. It says it's a spiritual altar, meaning since Christ, our head and teacher, is the true altar, his members and disciples are also spiritual altars on which the sacrifice of a life lived in holiness is offered to God. St. Augustine talks about how when we look at an altar, at the gifts that are brought up there, the bread and the wine, but also our income, a portion of our income, he says, you know, put yourself on that altar, offer yourself to God and see how God will transform you through the Holy Spirit. And one of the prayers that a priest prays, he says it quietly so you don't hear it, is he say, with humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord. May our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. So it's really about us putting ourselves on the altar, which is why we say at Mass too, pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. And what do you say? Father Tom?
Lord, accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of your name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Right, yes. Yeah. And then finally, the altar is a sign of Christ. So generally, when you come into a church, you kind of, there's two kind of things going on. You have the tabernacle with the stable presence of the Blessed Sacrament. You have an altar. So the general rule, and you have to work it by yourself, but basically the typical posture during Mass is we bow to the altar. We gather for the Eucharist, enacting the presence of Christ as a verb, something we do together. And we also have the Blessed Sacrament, which is the noun, which is really meant for communion to the sick and dying, for individual prayer, viaticum. So that's another whole side, which we could add that out because there's a lot there. But anyway, let me stay focused on the altar. The altar is a sign of Christ. Go ahead, Tom. Your question.
Well, there's a line in the rite, and actually in the worship aid that will be distributed on June 19th, there'll be a column on each, on the side of each page that has brief quotes from the order of dedication.
Okay, that's a good idea.
Because there's a catechetical piece to the worship aid for people to take home and study. Because there's just a lot of beautiful understandings, or you know, it's some deep theology that's in the but accessible and understandable for us. There's a line in there about how the altar is Christ. It talks about the early fathers declared the altar is Christ.
It's Christ, right?
Yeah.
Which is interesting too, because I was at a clergy formation day yesterday talking about the Eucharist and how we could have a revival of the Eucharist. And one of the priests pointed out, you know, the revival of the Eucharist is about a revival of a relationship with Christ as a person. And so in the rite of a dedication of an altar, you'll notice that we do all of the same stuff with that altar, the same rituals as we do with a person who's being initiated into the church.
Which we will get to.
Ordained as a, in the holy order as a bishop, priest, or deacon.
Let's get to that in a moment, but first let's just talk about one of the things that's really emphasized and built of living stones, which is the document that guides renovation and construction of churches. And that is the connection between the baptismal font and the altar. And as I've taken school kids, as they were ending school, I've been giving them all tours of the church so they could see. They really haven't seen it since they had their last Mass there in January. Or maybe December, if I think about it. And one of the things several of them have noticed is that there's a path, they call it a path from the font to the altar. Can you talk about, Chris, why that is significant?
Oh, and again, that's one of the criticisms of a lot of the church projects that were done, like at another parish, my previous parish, and many other parishes, is where do I focus my attention? In what direction I'm going? And so, while I really appreciate the efforts that were made at St. Anne's back in, what year was that when it was renovated before?
1986.
In the 1980s, that happened a lot. The idea of us drawing around that family table of ours to be more intimate, but we also lost some of the transcendence of God. And so when we gather for church, we're gathering as the body of Christ, but we're also you know, uniting, facing, you know, we would say heaven, the New Jerusalem, you probably did not bring this up with the kids, because actually the Eucharist completes our initiation into the church originally. We all think it's confirmation. No, that's for children who are baptized as infants. But if you've ever been to, well, you know, the Leaning Tower of Pisa in Italy, the Leaning Tower of Pisa is actually a bell tower for a parish church, which has an enormous baptistry, a separate building, probably larger than St. Anne's. And it was in there that the folks would gather at the Easter Vigil. Remember, we were there, Tom.
Right.
Easter Vigil, this big room with a baptistry in the middle. They would be in, they'd go in there, they'd be baptized and confirmed, and then they would go into the church for Eucharist. So the idea is when I
get and, the, here, and they probably had never been in that church before.
Good chance, right? Exactly. Yeah. Right. Yep. Good point. So imagine the mystery of that. So and the idea is when we come into that church, we recognize our initiation into the Paschal mystery, the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. So that's why it's great you have them both lined up on axis with one another.
Well, and it's such a prominent find until you come in. It really almost is like a recreation of what you find at Pisa. It's not separate buildings, but very distinct pieces, but clearly connected by what the kids called a path from the font to the altar. Well, and then to get to the dedication rite or the order of dedication of an altar, what was astounding to me was how loaded it is with baptismal images. And that goes to what you were saying about the altar as being almost like we regard it almost as a person in a way. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you want to talk about that? Like the first real, I mean, the most obvious symbol or image, that thing that we use in baptism is water. And that comes into play.
Right. So what will happen at the very beginning of the ritual, the bishop will bless the water and sprinkle the people, reminding us of our baptism, and then he will sprinkle the altar.
So
then, after hearing some, are you going to be using the readings for the day, Tom?
We are. So it's a solemnity of the body and blood of Christ. So we will use the readings of the day.
But after the homily, the bishop will continue the ritual of dedication, which begins with incense burning on the altar. Again, hearkening back to the temple in Jerusalem.
Anointing is for, it actually goes.
You're right, I just went over that. Saw the word.
It actually, sorry, Chris, yes. Chris, it goes in the order of baptism. Water, anointing, clothing, and light.
And that's why I forgot about the incense, because you don't usually use incense. And
So start with the anointing.
So water, it's anointed with chrism. It's like a confirmation. It's also the chrism that's used at ordinations and infant baptisms. And then the incense is burned on the altar, back again to that temple. And the song that I've often heard over the years, Lord, may our prayers rise like incense in your sight. May this place be filled with the fragrance of Christ.
Did you see our worship aid?
So that's probably one of the most commonly used ones. It's just a really easy one, good to say. And you repeat it several times so you can get it, I hope. Then they'll be dressed in a white garment, just like the newly baptized are dressed in their gown or an albe, which also priests wear at mass. Altar service wear at mass. That's the garment of the baptized, that white garment. And then finally, the candles are lit. And the candles, the bishop says, when the candles are lit, may the light of Christ shine upon the table of this altar. May those who share the Lord's Supper shine with his light. Tom, it looks like you're eager to say something.
No, I'm listening.
Oh, good. All right. And then mass continues in the usual way, more or less. One thing
then we get to actually, we celebrate Eucharist at this exactly, table that has been initiated. This table, just as once we are initiated, we come to the Lord's table. Now this table has been initiated and we will celebrate Eucharist on this table.
It's doing what it was created to do. Just like each of us was created to do what God created us to do. And sometimes figuring that out can be hard, but an altar, it's not so difficult. Yeah.
Did you, have you ever in any of your experiences in terms of the incensing? Because so one of the options it gives in describing this is that you would place a heap, or you would place a
yes,
like wax tapers, like a, you'd start a fire on the altar and then pour incense on it. Have you ever done that?
Not that way, but I do remember, Thomas, maybe you want to check with this, at the dedication of our St. Mary Magdalene Church in Kentwood, which was burned on July 3rd or 4th when fireworks were being set off. The whole place burned down and they finally built a gorgeous new church. But during the incense of the altar, the fire alarm went off.
And then that came up at our meeting with the diocesan folks. Yes, we've got that.
Good. Okay, so no, I've not seen that.
Okay.
But there's enough smoke there and fire that it did.
I mean, it is like starting a fire on the top of the altar.
Right, and they could not, but most places I've been to, we just burn incense on the altar.
We have a bowl. We have a bowl that we use that we'll use that day, with probably something on. Well, it doesn't burn that. It doesn't get that.
Let's go back. So you know, you're right. Eucharist continues like in the usual way, as I said, which can be routine. Unfortunately, it's really us always connecting Christ's sacrifice and that Last Supper on that altar or around that altar, that whole space. Some prayers to be aware of. One of them is like a prayer over the offerings. I mean, the gifts are brought forward. There's that prayer, pray friends on my sacrifice and yours that you respond to. And then the bishop will say, may your Holy Spirit come down upon this altar, we pray, O Lord our God, to sanctify the gifts of your people and graciously to cleanse the hearts of all who receive them through Christ our Lord. Isn't that beautiful? I would never want to be a bishop, let me tell you, and I never will, thank God. But the only reason I would ever want to be a bishop is to do this ritual, because the texts are just exquisite. Yeah. Can I do one more?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I was going to say,
there's not. You said mass, celebrating mass can be routine. There's not going to be anything routine about this celebration of mass, because first of all, we are going to be celebrating mass for the first time in this renovated church, and it's going to be just hoping that nobody trips over somebody or trips on something, or I mean, it's going to be, it'll be great. It'll be wonderful, but it's.
And it could be the only time in your entire life you get to experience the dedication of an altar. It doesn't happen very often.
I never have. Yeah.
So you haven't gone to other dedication masses?
Nope, I've never been to a dedication of an altar ever in my life.
Oh, no. So this is the prayer after communion. And I hope you put this one in the worship booklet. Let us pray. Keep us, O Lord, ever close to your altar, where the sacrament of sacrifice is celebrated, so that, united in faith and charity, we who by Christ are nourished into Christ may be transformed, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
It reminds me of just of what St. Augustine said, you know, we are what we eat. Where we are, who we eat, maybe. You know, it sounds kind of funny. And I'm also thinking too of at this professor I had at Notre Dame would always say, Father Robert Taft, Jesus did not come to change bread and wine. He came to change people. But unless we are devoted to the Eucharist, how else do we change or become who we want to be? It's so important. So.
Thank you, Chris. That would be an excellent homily for the massive dedication of an altar.
I love that Feast of Body and Blood of Christ. And I hope that maybe someday from your altar, you'll do a Eucharistic procession.
Okay. We will try. We will ponder that. We will take that into consideration.
And just a word too. There's that whole sensitivity about the location of the tabernacle. It's because there's that concern about a loss of belief among Catholics about our belief in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. And that is something we need to work at and work with. And I really appreciate how far we've come in the days when the Eucharist or the tabernacle would have been out of sight for most people in church. I think you're having a big improvement at St. Anne's. So it's there with you when you arrive to pray, but also it's not front and center. It's not the center, it's not where you're destined. You're destined to the altar of sacrifice.
Well, that was one of the things that our reimagining committee early on talked about, because one of the advantages of the Blessed Sacrament Chapel was that it was a place where people could go and pray privately. But one of the struggles with it is exactly what you're talking about, is that it wasn't visible or readily apparent as to where it was. And there's a nice, there's already a spotlight shining on the spot where it will be. And there will be kneelers there so people can go and pray there privately if they want to do that during the day.
So you can have an intimate encounter, or you can just, nice. I'll be quiet now because I know we want this to be quick things.
My friend Chris is obsessed with the title Quick Things. And I try to explain this to him, that it's quick things and then we go on to other things. But anyway, there are some other things we can talk about as to like what happens during the anointing of the altar, but it's kind of like with rehearsal. When you have candidates for initiation, for example, at the Easter Vigil, you want to kind of talk through the bare bones of what's going to happen, but you don't want to tell them too much because you also want to experience it and have it be revealed as you go along.
Yeah, like on those catechumens after they were baptized, the neophytes in Pisa. And I even think, oh my gosh, when you come into that church, where are you going to sit? You're going to go back to the same old seat where you sat before? You really can't. You know what I mean? Cool.
It will be that way because no one will have their same seat. That was what we said early on, is that including me, I will have a different seat too.
Will you all process in together, or will it be more a case of
we'll be arriving as you would on a normal Sunday.
Okay.
Be seated.
Okay.
Yeah. There will be enough uncertainty that we don't want to do that too. So.
Just one little thing, then I'm going to say goodbye, okay?
That time you have to hang on until we're done, but okay.
Okay. I just really appreciate how the efforts that Tom does to communicate to the parish. They are, I'm always humbled. I think another email, oh my gosh, another one? How does he do all that? But that's, I know my people would appreciate it.
I get emails complaining about all that.
I was making notes to myself for tonight's email because I forgot we're having a golf outing too.
Chris, thank you. This was a great introduction to what awaits us on June 19th. So remember, Mass that morning is at 9:30, just one Sunday morning Mass at 9:30 a.m. We hope everyone comes. Secondly, though, we will anticipate the Mass of Dedication by praying evening prayer in church at 7 p.m. on Saturday. We'll pretend the altar isn't even there. But it will be.
It'll be naked.
Just like the babies.
But you'll need a naked altar on
Good
Friday.
Just like the babies that come to be baptized.
Yep.
It'll be a great opportunity to come and spend some time in prayer and thanksgiving, beginning our praise of God for the altar that we will celebrate.
Hey Tom, if I came to your church on Saturday night, could I go to your altar like it was a little baby and touch it and say, oh.
No, you can't. But afterwards, if you have a raffle ticket, you can go outside.
Pardon me?
If you can't go and touch it, but afterward, you can go outside. And if you bought a raffle ticket, you might win the raffle. A raffle is going to be going on we'll draw the winning ticket right after evening prayer.
And the person who draws the winning ticket can touch the altar?
Sure. Okay. The person who wins the raffle can touch the altar. Okay, so again, Sunday, June 19th, Mass at 9:30, June 18th, evening prayer at 7 p.m. I want to conclude with two kindergarten jokes. The first one is kind of our end of the school year things. The first one actually came from April Fool's Day. So they gave me this plastic container with tin foil in, and inside it's full of, oh, you can't see it.
Jokes.
Brownies, but you can't see the brownie. It's an E colored brown.
Oh, that's fun.
So it's full of brownies. Okay, the other one. Where do polar bears put their money, Father Chris?
I'm stumped.
In a snowbank.
Oh, good. Okay.
Finally, as we begin summer, a prayer for from Father Austin Fleming in his Concord Pastor blog. Help me find a place to meet you, O Lord, a shady place, a grove of grace, where you and I might meet and sit together in the silence, in the shade, away from all the noise that fills my soul. Help me find a summer refuge at the shore or in the fields or up atop some mountain, a grotto of your presence, Lord, a haven where I'll find with you the peace my heart desires. This summer, Lord, help me find a place to meet you down the road or out of town or even right at home, a place where you and I might meet and sit together in the silence, in the shade, in the prayer that makes us one. Amen. Thank you, Chris.